Hello, BookTube, and welcome back to the library tour of Doom. This is a tour, book by book, through every book in my library, only we've got a little bit of a dipsy-doodle turn here, because it's not my library I'm using. But, nevertheless, the library tour of Doom crawls on, and a lot of the books that are in this library are either books that are in my library back in Boston, or books that are soon going to be in my library back in Boston. And this is a perfect example. I don't have this one at all. Some of you will remember these old, great old Signet classics. Look at this thing. No one will ever make a mass market copy of War and Peace ever again. It's just not the cost. The ROI, as the business BroTube channels say, is not ever going to favor this again. So it's never going to happen. But once upon a time, Penguin, Signet, Bantam, they all did these things. Look at this thing. This is an unabridged War and Peace translated by Ann Dunningham for the Signet line. You all know, you've seen, there's a shelf on one of my bookcases that has all of these Signet classics, and I don't have this one. But this is in perfect condition. And it brings up a Tolstoy translation issue that my current host, Mark Richardson of Richardson and Reads, and I were talking about on one of our endless book conversations. I can't remember if it was in the bright red truck while we're on one of Vermont's endless tree-lined roads, or whether it was in the living room over wine. I don't remember when it was. We've had a lot of those talks. But we were talking about the contrasting merits or lack thereof of Tolstoy translations like Pevyar and Volkonsky, who try in their Tolstoy translations to preserve the oddness, the awkwardness. If Tolstoy, as he often does, comes to a long paragraph and uses the same word seven times in the paragraph, Pevyar and Volkonsky will include it every time. They will just, it will be that metronymic beat of that word over and over again. If Tolstoy lapses into French, as he often does for long stretches, including the very beginning of this book, they will just give you the French. And, you know, there might be footnotes, but it, to say that it blasts apart the reading momentum is putting it mildly. And then you have the earlier generation of Tolstoy translators, like the Mauds or Rosemary Edmonds, who don't do that, or Edwards. They instead translate the work not only in its substance, but in its style. They make it English novels. They make English novels out of what Tolstoy wrote. And it's not like there's a lot of violence being done here, right? It's not like the ghost of Tolstoy is yelling any more than he would ordinarily yell, because he knew what those English language translations were like, and he approved of a lot of the earlier ones. He just wanted his book, in its essence, to reach as many people as possible. So it wasn't like he was saying, oh, look at the travesty these Americans are making of my book. He might have privately thought that, but he didn't ever object to the Mauds in their translation of War and Peace, for instance. And I fell in love with those English translations. This is a perfect example of that. So some of you will know how War and Peace begins, where one character is moaning to another at an aristocratic party about how grabby Napoleon Bonaparte is for territory. So how does this begin? Okay, see? The whole of the beginning of this book is in French. But here, Dunnigan has only given you the first part of the first line in French with no translation. Interesting. I forgot that. There's no translation of that. So the first line of the greatest Russian classic of them all is in French. But then we move on from there into just conversational English. And it works wonderfully. Now, the only drawback here, I hate to say it, of course, is that I don't know that a paperback like this could stand the strain. And this thing is, what is this? This Signet Classic was $2.25 when it was on the stands, and it came out in 1968. So this is an old paperback. And it's an old paperback of a 1,200-page book. I'm not sure that this would survive you reading it. I'm not sure that it would. For instance, I knew someone who read their way through the old Signet Classic paperback of Don Quixote. And that person is going to make you book people just shiver in horror. That person realized that their paperback was too thick to survive a reading from front to back. So when she would get finished with a part of the book, she would just tear it out. She would just tear it off the mass market paperback. So that she figured, I kept saying, why are you doing that? You'll never be able to revisit this book. And she said, A, I'm never going to be able to revisit this copy anyway. And B, it's so encouraging. Every time I pick it up, it's a shorter book. I've never forgotten. She's long gone, but I've never forgotten that sacrilegious comment. And that would be true here. you might want this, but I don't think you could read it. Fortunately, the old house here is the same as Hyde Cottage in that there are no shortage of War and Peace translations, although I'd be willing to bet this is the only Ann Dunningan that's here. One way or another, that is your library tour of doom for today. It is nothing less than War and Peace, a book I would love for us to canonize on BookTube with a 40-person read-along. Imagine it. A 40-person Zoom call at the end of every chapter where people just weigh in, where we go through it slowly over the course of a whole year. Oh, what fun that would be. And if I had my druthers, I know exactly which 40 BookTubers I would pick, without doubt. But it's a huge endeavor. Maybe we'll get to it on this channel anyway. But that's your library tour of doom for today. We'll try and pick something shorter tomorrow. Thank you, BookTube.